Hi friends, welcome to the NP Telco's Leadership for India Inc. Practical Concepts and Constructs. We are in week 12 discussing legendary leadership. In this week, we'll focus on Steve Jobs, who was an outstanding technology visionary. He represented life and soul of technology. Steve Jobs, the CEO of Apple Inc., who passed away on October 5, 2011, was an iconic leader of technology and business. If Apple products have achieved a cult status, and if Apple has become the first company in the world to cross $2 trillion in market capitalization, Steve's technological genius and business leadership are responsible. Steve Jobs was undoubtedly one of the greatest technology visionaries and business leaders of all time. Steve Jobs defined what words like creativity, innovation, and connectivity actually mean through his products and customer experiences. Steve Jobs clearly belongs to the rare class of leaders who give depth and substance to the concepts that are abstractly talked about but are never fully and truly experienced by the users. The world, not merely the domain of technology or the field of consumer electronics, became poorer by his departure. He made several unique and pioneering contributions. Over the two decades of stewardship, Steve pioneered a computing and connectivity revolution which changed irrevocably how the world networks and experiences itself. Through his several product and process contributions that took creativity and innovation to newer heights, Steve Jobs transformed consumer electronics. Whether it was iMac, iPod, iPhone, iPad, or Apple Watch and Apple TV, each of his devices was an epitome of elegance and aesthetics with high performance, reliability, and durability. Each device brought in a level of consumer experience that was never before experienced at that point of time. Steve's genius lay in the fact that his products had a universal appeal, from highly developed markets to low-income markets, and from affluent consumers to indigent consumers. Segmentation as defined for decades by marketing gurus had no relevance for Apple products and customers. iPhone, for example, has a universal appeal. I would say that Steve Jobs was a pioneer in designing and developing a product with total universality in its appeal in the marketplace. The original iPhone was introduced by Steve Jobs on January 9, 2007 at the Macworld Conference and Expo held in San Francisco, California. In his address, Jobs said, "This is a day that I have been looking forward to for 2.5 years, adding that today, Apple is going to reinvent the phone, and how the phone was reinvented by him is history." Jobs introduced the iPhone as a combination of three devices: a widescreen iPod with touch controls, a revolutionary mobile phone, and a breakthrough internet communicator. You can see here Steve Jobs launching the first iPhone, and it was a revolutionary transformation priced at that point of time at $199 for an 8GB configuration. Collaborators and competitors have been one in praising the enormous transformation he brought about in the deployment of digital technology to improve and enhance everyday living. He was a genius who was also artistic at heart. Even more remarkable is the fact that even as a technologist and businessman, Steve Jobs is compared with some of the greatest artists of all time, like Mozart, Picasso, and Leonardo da Vinci. Steve Jobs was an artist and genius extraordinaire who integrated many aspects of product design, delivery, and usage artfully and artistically. The integration covered the following: technology and art at one level, hardware and software at a very essential level, materialism and emotion at the consumer level, and business and life at the firm level. He was an amazing inventor of product concepts, an astounding integrator of ecosystems, and an awesome creator of customer experiences. This lecture draws certain important lessons and insights from his leadership as to how thinking differently can make highly positive and significantly transformative changes to individuals, firms, societies, and nations. The greatest contribution of Steve Jobs was in making computers and smart devices a part of daily living at work and off work. This was a key driver of all of his work. He converted the digital divide into digital connectivity. Steve Jobs co-founded Apple with Steve Wozniak in 1976. He invented the world's first truly personal computer in 1977. He kept on transforming the computing and connectivity world with stunning new products. He bridged the device divide. Until the 1980s, computers were for offices and businesses, while entertainment devices were for homes and families. Steve made computers truly and sensitively personal devices capable of handling arts, graphics, media, and entertainment. Apple brought out new devices that set new standards in elegance and performance. He pioneered the integration of media in all forms with handheld portable Apple devices such as iPods, iPhones, and iPads. Steve transformed the digital divide into digital connectivity. Productivity that comes out of efficient organization of activities and motivation that results from sensory satisfaction are achieved through Steve's Apple products, and that made life both productive and pleasurable for the consumers. He was also a pioneer in what I call device socialism. Equally important has been the socialistic philosophy of Steve Jobs, unexpressed but expressed in terms of the products. This probably has not been understood well. He believed in device universality and commonness of aspirations across segments. The pre-Steve Jobs wisdom was that every other industry or business corporation should believe in offering products at a lower level, so-called utilitarian, to one stratum of the society, and products should be offered at a higher level, so-called luxury products, to another stratum. That was the pre-Steve Jobs wisdom. Steve's paradigm was entirely different. In total contrast to such a practice, Steve offered one standardized, high-technology, high-value product to all sections of the society. From the managing director of a corporation to the chauffeur, people liked to have an iPhone, and it was not infrared for the managing director or the chief executive officer to have the same iPhone which his chauffeur had. He also did not believe in the practice of either skimming the market with hyped up value and usurious pricing or fragmenting it with broken technologies and flexible pricing. He thought he made a great product available a price point for all consumers in the same common standardized form. In fact, his products were the same whether for billionaires or for commoners. In the first several years of iPod, iPhone, and iPad revolution, he offered only one standardized model for all customer segments. The success factor that governed Apple and Steve Jobs was this: the user experience from his products was so classy, yet so natural and personalized, that neither the rich nor the not so rich found themselves alienated from his universal designs. He never had to make his iPhone with titanium or platinum, or bedeck it with crystals or diamonds for the rich to differentiate it from the standard iPhone for the masses. In a sense, Steve achieved an immense measure of social equalization with his technological virtuosity, an achievement which political and social campaigns also could not ever achieve. Steve Jobs' digital connectivity is more than a technological feat. It is a transformational phenomenon of social equalization and an universal harmonization in the device world. If only more corporate leaders become attuned to this philosophy of providing high product value and exceptional consumer experience, industries would be more scale efficient, waste avoiding, and cost competitive. How does this work out? Through minimalist design and maximal impact. The contributions of Steve Jobs in the field of design are phenomenal. From form factor simplification to control optimization, each generation of products brought out minimalist designs for maximal impact. Steve's minimalist design has had successive definitions through his products, each topping the other, almost as objectives of varied art. Like works of art, the previous versions did not feel obsolete. His products blended harmoniously with myriad environmental ambiences, even while retaining an outstanding differentiation. Apple products, especially the iSeries, demonstrate that a well-designed and elegantly crafted form factor can be as durable and as compelling as a corporate logo. His design philosophy defines the term trademark in terms of emotional ownership by his users, which no amount of legal ownership that trademark rights can fetch to a company. The fact that people stood in queues patiently, irrespective of the weather conditions, to get their hands on the first released iPhone or iPod was a great testimony to the attachment the customers had for his products and how he converted smart devices into a cult phenomenon for the millennials, as also for the elderly people. Apple's design philosophy, set by Steve Jobs, has been so strong that successive generations only built on the foundational design strengths, marking change with continuity. You can see that in these products. Steve Jobs also defined the making of a blockbuster product. The graphic below presents how Steve Jobs designed and developed Apple products, not only as epitomes of technological advancement, but also as elegant works of art. Very few manufacturers can match Apple on scoring 10 out of 10 on factors of blockbuster product design, development, manufacturing, and delivery. What are those blockbuster factors? One, functionalization beyond imagination. When the iPhone or iPod came out first, the functionality and experience which the products provided were beyond imagination of the users at that point of time. Flawless performance was the second factor. Unmatched quality, again another factor. Exceptional price value advantage. Reliable service assurance. Panache for perfection from product to packaging to delivery. Effective customer connectivity. And of course, the creative and elegant design representing the Apple trademark of any product. The biggest contribution of Steve Jobs has been in terms of redefining products in terms of customer experience. Connect with customers has been taken to a new level by staying ahead of customer expectations consistently. With Steve Jobs' demise, it fell on his successor, Tim Cook, to carry forward the legacy. Already a part of Steve Jobs' leadership team as head of supply chain from 1998 and as chief operating officer from 2007, Tim became the chief executive officer in 2011 upon the demise of Steve Jobs, and he carried forward the legacy with aplomb. Innovation and perfection were the hallmarks of Steve Jobs. Tim Cook brought in more perfection. He also brought in more innovation, bringing in greater variety of iPhones and also introducing Apple Watch as a health companion. At times, change becomes inevitable due to internal or external developments. Changing for the better while continuing with what clearly is the best propels a firm to greater successes. Jobs created such a lasting foundation for Apple based on innovation and perfection. Tim Cook developed and built on the change with continuity paradigm admirably. We discussed the change with continuity paradigm even in respect of Tata conglomerate, particularly various companies which were motivated to do better on their solid foundations but with appropriate adaptations to the environment. Apple, of course, represents the pinnacle of innovation with perfection. The other aspects of Apple's design philosophy are equally compelling. Many of Steve Jobs' design innovations were first-time introductions for the industry and the markets and had little follow-through competition. Steve Jobs' product technology had been intuitive, universal, and user-friendly. His products aligned perfectly with natural human behavior of explore and experience. From the scroll and click mouse he pioneered for his personal computers initially, to the touch and feel he developed for his smart devices, Jobs transformed computers into a great sensory and audiovisual experience. He pioneered the use of intuitive self-use and self-training controls for his devices. No one needed to read complex manuals or go through multi-step tutorials to start using Apple products. Highly intuitive, feeling natural and helpful in terms of self-corrective features, all of Apple's products designed by him would distinguish themselves in terms of user experiences. Steve Jobs pioneered a design philosophy which made the devices the companions of the users. Neither the devices controlled the users nor vice versa. This feature thrived continuously, with Apple Watch taking the companionship concept to new horizons. What was the design language that Steve Jobs adopted? He has done what was for long impossible. He infused life into technology, rendered its functioning soulful, and made technology intelligible to even the uninitiated. His humanized technologies were visible in the Mac graphics, the computer mouse, touch slide pinch movements, sensory commands, and voice commands. Apple's design philosophy set by Steve Jobs has been so strong that succeeding leadership generation has only built on the design strengths, making change with continuity. Steve Jobs' design philosophy has been commercially successful while being aesthetically elegant. Diverse smartphone models or portable music players from leading technology companies in the aggregate could not make any dent on the leadership position of Apple products in terms of either design strengths or market attraction. This graphic below shows the growth of iPhone from the time the product was launched up to 2011. You can see the successive generations of iPhone and how they built volumes and scale, going up to 30 million users in terms of iPhone 4S by 2011. If more scientific and technology leaders pursue simplicity and focus for optimal performance, the design to delivery value chain would be that much more impactful for the corporations as well as for all of their stakeholders. He also pioneered digital ecosystem. One of the fundamental contributions of Steve Jobs has been the creation of a global ecosystem that connected all the stakeholders of the firm's value chain, functional business value chain, and customer value chain into one integrated value chain seamlessly. He also made significant changes in how operations are conducted. From make or buy approach, he converted manufacturing and operations into a globally networked partnership. So make or buy decisions became network partnership decisions through a globally networked partnership mode of OEM component system and outsourcing. Apple's global ecosystem was sufficiently independent to be specialized and yet strongly connected to the Apple ecosystem. There was a time when make or buy was a procurement decision. The concept of integration came up later to define the strategic choices of a corporation to have the full value chain within itself or focus only on a few core competencies internally. All of these approaches were based on getting some economics out of the purchasing decision. More recently, the wave of outsourcing has overwhelmed the world as a powerful instrument of cost competitiveness with time effectiveness. However, no leader has encompassed all of these concepts under one umbrella of creating a virtual global ecosystem by which all the current stakeholders and future value drivers would combine to add value. The ability to conceptualize and establish a global ecosystem connecting all the three value chains, all the geographies, and all the stakeholders seamlessly is a unique leadership capability that Steve Jobs possessed. To come back to design language again, Steve Jobs had done what was for long impossible. He had infused life into technology, rendered its functioning soulful, and made technology intelligible to even the uninitiated. Sony must have thought about content first. Sony certainly realized the importance of media and entertainment to development of electronics much earlier than Apple. However, the best concept came from Apple and Steve Jobs. It was Steve Jobs who pioneered the integration of music and movies into the Apple ecosystem through his iPod 2001 and iTunes 2003, providing a seamless media connectivity to the user. While some viewed this as an attempt to regulate consumer freedom through proprietary digital platform, eventually his contribution to making unlimited choice available to the consumer and curbing media piracy to support the media corporations is well acknowledged. Equally impactful has been his unprecedented contribution to application development for his devices. In fact, the true era of application development arrived with only the iDevices, more particularly the iPhone and iPad. Application development is the model of virtual integration at its best, providing unlimited computing, connecting, reading, gaming, and entertainment capability to the Apple devices through third-party applications. Apple could secure over 500,000 applications for its iPhone in the very first few years. This speaks of the success of the Apple digital ecosystem, wherein any creative and capable software developer could come up with front-ranking applications. Coming up with that kind of application ecosystem was the first in the consumer electronics industry, and that was pioneered by Steve Jobs. Some of the application developers could themselves evolve into medium scale and mega scale enterprises in due course. Angry Birds is a great example of this. Also, At a time when manufacturers consider retailing to be a different expertise, Steve Jobs propounded the concept of Apple stores to enable and enhance integrated user experience. What is the digital ecosystem that he pioneered? He not only infused life into technology, rendering its functioning soulful, but also made retailing and consumer experience truly emotive and of lasting attachment. Is it retailing or is it customer experiencing? And Steve Jobs answered by saying it is customer experiencing. At a time when manufacturers consider retailing to be a different expertise, Steve Jobs propounded the concept of Apple stores to enable and enhance integrated user experience. Within 3 years, with 320 retail stores, 237 of which were in the USA, Apple retail network extended the integration of the ecosystem further. Each store set new standards for customer experience. In 2011, Apple started its iCloud service, which seamlessly stores all of the music, photos, movies, documents, applications, mails, calendars, and many others, and wirelessly pushes them to all of the Apple device users. The strategies of integration, outsourcing, and collaboration thus became one under a vision of digital ecosystem for Apple products, services, and consumers. For all the participants, it was as if they were living in their own world, to live in as a digital home, individualized, customized for each individual. He was also a pioneer of the global value chain approach. Until Jobs came on the scene, the automobile industry and consumer electronics industries were two industries that had a global value chain that were both standalone and networked. However, it was Jobs who created a completely unified global R&D and manufacturing network for Apple products in the consumer electronics space. Industries were characterized at that point of time by generational, performance, and styling differentials in the models offered for different countries, constraining the operation of a true global value chain. Industries exerted to retain critical components within the developed country supply chains and within collaborating groups, tied together by ownership or loyal supply history. Steve Jobs had a different concept of a unified product design for the globe, with R&D being under total control in the US, and the rest distributed across the globe for optimal techno-economics. You can see the Apple global chain in the image that is provided here. In one of the previous lectures, I presented to you Apple's global supply chain system with illustration. Steve Jobs designed the devices for the globe from America, sourcing components from even potential competitors, for example, Samsung, in respect of displays, basing the final assembly in China and generating huge value for Apple and USA through global sales. Not recognizing the potential of India in manufacturing and marketing, of course, was his early failing. However, Tim Cook corrected it. Steve Jobs' contributions in bringing Asia on its own as the global production hub of smartphones and tablets is acknowledged by not only the leaders of the component firms, but also the leaders of the governments. Taiwan, China, Korea, Singapore, and Japan drive the availability of critical components for Apple devices. Despite the huge scale of procurement and critical scope, Apple has followed single vendor and concentrated country supply chain policy to great success in most cases. Part of the answer could lie in Apple's penchant for integration under one ecosystem and the consequent assurance stakeholders perceive in terms of sustainable coexistence and growth. That said, Apple's supply chain strategy is perhaps one of the more guarded aspects of the even otherwise secretive company. Flawless launch of products in millions of units of any product the world over is possible only through a finely controlled and coordinated supply chain system, and Apple has achieved this feat. The lesson for leaders is that global value chain can only be optimal on the basis of two primary factors. One, design superiority that provides the strength to source even from the competitors as much as from dependent vendors, and two, an overall ecosystem that provides assurance to all stakeholders through collaborative forecasting and planning. Simple elegance as strategy. The achievements of Steve Jobs are built on just two core foundations of simplicity and elegance, although a lot of science and technology went behind these two core foundations. These two core foundations have supported a superstructure of seven principles that drove every aspect of his technology and management. We will consider each of those seven principles one by one. But fundamentally, if you look at the whole range of Apple products, we can conclude that style is substance. In his point of view, style of a product is the supreme consideration. From the very initial days, Jobs and Apple believed in style, in neat, clean, and clear fonts, in attractive, explanatory, and friendly graphics, in elegant form factor with pleasant touch and feel experience, and in marketing with style and in dramatic detail. Style is also substance for him. Jobs merged the left brain, which is logical and linear, and the right brain, which is creative and emotional, in his design philosophy, operation strategy, and customer connectivity. And together, these became distinctive. Jobs' knowledge and appreciation of calligraphy, which he learned as a dropout at Reed College, came back to support him years later to add detail, distinction, and differentiation to his products. These unique competencies enabled Steve Jobs to develop a unique design language and execute it perfectly in R&D, manufacturing, marketing, and the overall ecosystem. He established that style is indeed the substance. We have considered in the previous lecture how core competency is a cluster of competencies of a firm which are difficult to replicate by any other firm. If you look at Apple's core competency, which is supported by the cluster of competencies I talked about and would talk about, and see how difficult it has been for any other company to replicate, you will understand the concept of core competence, and it is demonstrated very effectively by Apple under Steve Jobs. Let's look at timeliness as strategy. Steve Jobs utilized timeliness as a competitive strategy. The concept of time as he executed was not one of go-to-market with the least time lapse from the first ideation. Rather, it was one of providing speed and efficiency in the hands of the users. The time factor was used by him as an advantage to the user and the firm, not merely for the firm to put products at an early point of time and earn dollars. That was not the case. From the response time to the navigation speeds, his devices delivered time advantage to the users. Whether at Apple or the intervening Next Computer Services or Pixar Studios, he utilized every moment to develop or ideate on novel products. His brightest ideas were well-timed. For example, he waited to launch the devices ready in the late 1990s, only after the broadband revolution in 2000s. Steve Jobs proved that timeliness does not merely mean fast go-to-market. It involved for him developing things in advance and timing them for entry along with other supportive technological developments for optimal benefits to the users. He believed in thrill being an enthralling phenomenon. A key leadership trait is the ability to be inspiring for an organization, but few leaders extended it to the entire ecosystem as Steve Jobs did. There lied his unique enthralling capability. He always looked at the future possibilities, even as he launched the current products. As he launched his devices, Steve Jobs created a rare thrill which transported his entire ecosystem of Apple organization, component suppliers and vendors, application developers, and more importantly, the users, into a world of immense future possibilities. He also had a fine sense of intuitive futurism. By eschewing market research and instead relying on his own perception of futuristic consumer needs, Jobs converted launch events into much anticipated dramatic rides into future. All Apple semi-annual launch events helmed by Steve Jobs were inevitably thrilling and enthralling, representing an epitome of masterly showmanship and universal marketing. You can look at this as the intuitive way of leadership. Apple did not rely on data, market research, and a whole lot of surveys to conclude which products would be required in future. Steve Jobs relied on his inner voice, the intuitive feel, to develop products which consumers would love and embrace. The Apple tradition of global launch of operating systems and devices is followed up with dedication by his successor Tim Cook and emulated by other companies. However, Steve Jobs continues to be unmatched in the inspirational thrill that he alone could generate when launching products or when speaking about them. He also succeeded from errors. It is not that either Steve Jobs or Apple was never in fault. However, they converted every error into a success trigger. Apple struggled initially with Mac computers, while Steve had to antagonize his board and lost the job despite several innovations between 1976 and 1985. He lost the company, especially the control of Apple, in May 1985. He lost money in his subsequent entrepreneurial attempt, Next Computers. However, he went through an introspective quest. His own share of personal tribulations and unsatisfying spiritual questions had more questions than answers. Yet, he came out of all of that a completely rejuvenated person and a leader whose intuitive thinking became the better of his personality, whose passion for perfection and innovation got the better of his professional personality. He became open, bold, and confident. He, to the extent that he was happy to have the CEO of Google on the board of Apple, and he was not concerned whether Google could be a competitor in operating systems and mobiles in the future era. Nothing deterred Steve Jobs from discovering his spark of creativity to shape technology into breakthrough products and services, from digitally animated movies through Pixar to device ideations through Next and Apple. Neither did he slur over the failings. He improved processes, for example, supplier scrutiny, and products, for example, antenna grip. So, wherever he was, he came up with innovations. Even if those innovations didn't prove to be commercial successes the way he anticipated, he understood what was the missing link and then filled in those gaps and made better products out of his next ventures. And that was succeeding from errors for Steve Jobs. He also believed in technology for all. In the fast-changing technology world, established companies are often overtaken by younger startups with more creative and disruptive technologies. But did that happen to Apple? No. Apple remains as young and as creative as it was when Steve Jobs took over the reins again. He demonstrated that Apple, even at 25, and he himself at 56, could be more creative than anyone else. Apple products were not merely cool to the adolescents and young professionals, but equally appealing to the elderly and homemaking wives. Jobs continued to brim with creativity in his 50s, as he had been in his 20s. Despite undergoing a decade-long traumatic fight with cancer, Jobs continued to ideate and execute on his dream devices. Creativity, non-aging capability, and being undeterred by life's challenges were the hallmarks of his personal passion. Indefatigable spirit marked Steve Jobs' leadership. It is this passion for perfect innovation that drove Steve to bring in amazing new products each time. He also believed in team perfection. While there is no denying Steve Jobs' singular leadership, he had also built an outstanding team of 10 creative and differentiated leaders who delivered perfection in their domains. I talk about four people here. Jonathan Ive, who headed design, is credited with Apple's minimalist Snow White design. Scott Forstall drove successive iOS developments. Tim Cook demonstrated exemplary supply chain prowess. Ron Johnson's retail strategy provided end-to-end competencies. The smooth succession of Tim Cook to the CEO role upon the demise of Steve Jobs also signifies the timely development of internal leadership talent at Apple. Wealth is business health. That was a dictum for Steve Jobs. Steve Jobs is not known to have contributed or part transcendent wealth to charity, as Bill Gates and Warren Buffett have done. He, however, believed in creation of business health with generation of employment and elevation of quality of life. The current status of Apple, built on Steve Jobs' foundations, illustrates this. Today, Apple employs 137,000 employees globally. Its global revenues have crossed $260 billion, 2019 figures. Its global profits crossed $57 billion, 2019 figures again. At least 200 top global vendors support the supply chain of Apple phones and other devices. And the countries of operations are virtually the entire world. And its market capitalization has crossed $2 trillion as of August 2020. The national wealth he generated through Apple and the sheer scale of his product development and manufacturing and the global marketing of his products created more jobs and career opportunities than any other comparable industrial or charitable activity. Jobs illustrated that wealth earned innovatively through humanization of technology is the best way to ensure sustainable health of businesses. Apple iPod, iPhone and iPad sales grew phenomenally together. The sales of these three devices from first quarter of 2006 to fourth quarter of 2018 in million units illustrates this. Each generation of iPod, iPhone and iPad had surge buying in the quarter of introduction, followed by steady demand. This annual cycle was a response to generational innovations. In 2019 Q4, the category revenue is constituted by iPhone 52%, iPad 7%, Mac 11%, wearables 10% and services 20%. This innovation spree also saw the phasing out of iPod once iPhone became the mainstream device. He was not doggedly and dogmatically in love with his first innovative devices. When he thought that iPhone completely overshadowed iPod, he was not unwilling to let go of iPod. He brought in successive new devices and, if necessary, phased out the earlier devices to make sure that the technological innovation continued without getting hamstrung by the product legacies. That was his contribution to the product philosophy. As an Apple's co-founder and as a leader of an era, he has got several credits to his profile. Between 1984 and 1992, he got the early success with Mac. In 91 and to 1997 period, he had decline and restructuring experience at Apple. However, when he returned to the company in 1997, the next decade saw return to profitability with him at the helm. And from 2007, with a full line of smart devices, there was just no looking back for Apple. Apple's growth since rehiring Steve Jobs 20 years ago can be seen from this chart. From $7 billion in 1997, to $216 billion in 2016 and more than $260 billion currently reflects the kind of growth he steered at Apple. He co-founded Apple and was known to brim with impatience, seeking to develop perfect and innovative products, even if there were only a few. He never believed in segmenting the market with multiple products. He departed after a fight with John Sculley in 1985 and made an epochal return in 1997 to lead Apple to great heights with innovation. And the way the market cap grew from $3 billion in 1996 to $624 billion in 2016 and currently to over $2 trillion in 2020 is a great proof of how Apple became the darling of stock markets, not for any reason other than the product profile, the product spectrum, and the scope for innovation the company showcases every 6 months. The charts above and the phases of startup, decline, turnaround, and growth, wherein the company lost out without Steve Jobs and grew with Steve Jobs, reflected the innovation leadership that Steve Jobs provided. It also reflects how a great leader can make a world of difference to a company. Steve Jobs was truly a global leadership icon. Apple has seen dramatic growth in revenues, profits and market capitalization with the re-entry of Steve Jobs as Apple CEO from 1997. We have seen the kind of growth which Apple underwent under Steve Jobs upon his return. The growth achieved by Apple in a product-based industry contrasted sharply with the decline of America in product innovation during the same period. This illustrates the importance of leadership. We are aware that in the 1990s and 2000s, America lost its capability in terms of world-class product innovation and world-class manufacturing efficiency. If at all, Japan, South Korea, and other countries began taking the lead. In the automobile industry, Toyotas and Nissans of the world began ruling the roads. Similarly, in consumer electronics, Sony, and other companies such as Sharp, they began ruling the arena. And in various other fields, it was the Japanese and Koreans, including Samsung and Daewoo and Hyundai, which began having the ascendancy. And during that time, Steve Jobs demonstrated an amazing model of aggressive and accelerating business growth based on breakthrough products. By focusing on simplicity, elegance, perfection, and friendliness, he created an ecosystem of products and services that had sustainability and economic development at their core. The Apple products which he designed touched and shaped as never before every part of human life and much of social connectivity. Steve's life, which provided the much needed life and soul to technology, would inspire corporate leaders as well as bright men and women. His leadership inspires others to focus on the hard but highly rewarding aspect of driving sustainable growth through innovation, elegance, and perfection in design, manufacturing, and marketing. So if you see Steve Jobs' overall leadership, you can visualize a leader who had a complete end-to-end understanding of how products can be designed, manufactured, and delivered in the marketplace. And he also understood what would make a differentiated success in each of these domains, how simplicity, elegance, perfection, user functionality, user experience could make a world of difference in product design. He also understood how manufacturing efficiency, global supply chain optimality, and globally networked production would make a world of difference to manufacturing efficiency and operational excellence. He understood how providing a first-hand experience in terms of highly classy Apple retail stores would make the world of difference to the consumers in the marketing era. And all of that he had in his mind as one complete, so to say, a 70mm movie in his mind. And his mental faculties were so flexible and so dynamic that he could achieve this over and over again with successive generation of each product line, be it iPhone, iPad, or Apple Watch, and also expand that to newer product regimes as time started rolling on. And that is his leadership. The leadership to be creative, to be able to visualize the complete product life cycle and establish an infrastructure that can take care of it from design through manufacturing to delivery was his high point. As I said, and worth repeating again, Steve's life provided the much needed life and soul to technology. It would inspire corporate leaders as well as bright men and women. His leadership inspires others to focus on the hard but highly rewarding aspect of driving sustainable growth through innovation, elegance, and perfection in design, manufacturing, and marketing. So I would say that he represented the magic of technology. He demonstrated to us how the products could provide us with magical experience when we try to see them, feel them, or use them. And his life had that message. He never tried to explain his own leadership message as others tried to do. Unlike Jack Welch or other leaders, Steve Jobs never made an attempt to discuss or describe his managerial or leadership thoughts in conferences or other public forums. That one exception was the famous Stay Hungry, Stay Foolish commencement address at Stanford University. He made an intensely personal address when he took upon himself the responsibility of delivering the commencement at Stanford University in 2005. However, that speech went on to become one of the most quoted speeches ever. It was very sharply introspective. His address is still described as life-changing and career-transforming. The three personal stories he narrated in the speech were unique. His life certainly would inspire generations for the power of their simplicity, just as his Apple products would continue to thrill generations with the elegance, innovation, and perfection of technology. As discussed in this lecture through multiple examples, the legend that Steve Jobs is one that would live on through generations of human enterprise and endeavor. For the elegant model of perfect innovation he built, we can make products which are innovative, people can make products which are perfect, but to make products which are perfectly innovative or innovatively perfect only an outstanding and once in a lifetime leader can do. And that was Steve Jobs for us. So we have considered earlier leaders from the fields of public eminence and the field of education. You can see from those leaders how they have excelled themselves in their respective fields. And if you can see something which is common, it is the connectivity. Dr. Abdul Kalam connected himself admirably with every stakeholder, be it a small child or a student of a school or a student of college or member of parliament. He connected with everybody, not merely in terms of the position, and actually in spite of the position, he connected with everybody through knowledge. He was a self-made man. He overcame all obstacles and became a leading scientist and developed several products that were helpful for India's civilian and military needs. And he demonstrated that nothing stands between him and his people, not even the August office, as far as connectivity goes. That was one type of connectivity. Then we had Dr. Sikri Prahlad in our consideration. I demonstrated how he came up with great concepts, very innovative strategy concepts, very innovative management concepts. But more importantly, how he connected each of these concepts and made a holistic strategic agenda for organizations. Again, even more importantly, he took to the various fora. He appeared at various public and private forums and spread his message. He articulated the concepts which he brought about. Again, he did something different. He focused on the bottom of the pyramid. He came up with the concept of people who are in poverty being people who also can drive profits for firms, provided the firms understand the bottom of the pyramid in the right manner. So he came up with the concept of firms working in partnership with the indigent sections of the population. He came up with this wonderful concept of there being micro consumers, micro producers, micro innovators and micro investors. He also connected the developed world with the developing world. He connected the rich with the poor. He connected the governments with the firms. He connected the shy and diffident and insecure industrialists with the new horizon which was beckoning them to take India onto the global stage. So connectivity was his great strength, and consumer orientation was his great appeal. And he always believed that much of the competition comes in not from the external world but from the organization's own ossification over time. Now we have seen Steve Jobs. Steve Jobs connected himself through his products with the rest of the world. He developed products which the people accepted, which the people used, and which the people loved. He gave to the consumers the experience even before they understood what that experience meant for them. And that was his greatness. And he believed in a universal design. And he demonstrated that one design can meet the entire market. There was no need in his philosophy to segment the market into innumerable layers and then start offering different products for different segments. That was needless complexity in his view. He came up with this single standardized model of iPhone and simply swamped the market with that. In that respect, we can say that he was the Henry Ford of the consumer electronics industry, because just as Henry Ford came up with the standardized manufacture of automobile and then transformed the assembly line manufacturing system and therefore made automobile industry an intensely mass consumer industry, Steve Jobs also transformed the consumer electronics industry through his standardized design philosophy into one which is integrated in terms of excellence and efficiency. Not only that, he combined the true attributes of a great product perfection and innovation. He came up with the theory, which I have interpreted as being style is substance. And it is true, because you cannot have a stylish product unless there is a lot of technology behind that style. You cannot have finely rounded curved device unless you have the ability to have that level of perfection in machining and the kind of materials which make that kind of smooth flow possible. You cannot have miniaturization unless you have the ability to reduce the components inside the phone. You cannot have the ability for a product to meet multiple needs unless you understand how multiple technologies can be packed into one single design. So when he brought out style, he brought out style because there was substance which he innovated and which he manufactured and which he packaged in terms of one single product. And that's the inspiration he brings to us. And he created digital homes for his users. He made sure that people had one seamless experience of having connectivity and traceability and restorability for all their document needs, for all their media needs, for all their photographic needs. In fact, therefore, he created a digital world for each of his customers. And the way the devices started communicating, Apple Siri being the pioneering venture in that, pioneering initiative in that, again reflected his futuristic thinking. And several of the products which we may be seeing now could for all probability been made into developmental prototypes during his time as well. That was the level of foresight and forethought he had, and that was the manner in which he shaped the entire organization into a talent crucible. I would always remember Steve Jobs as the epitome of perfect innovation or innovative perfection. So as discussed in this lecture through multiple examples, the legend that Steve Jobs is one that would live on through generations of human enterprise and endeavor for the elegant model of perfect innovation he built. And that's what should inspire us to treat science and technology with great respect, and in whatever way we can bring life and soul of technology for social good. Thank you very much. We'll meet again in the next lecture.